فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، إن شاء الله تعالى today we're going to start the kitab, كتاب الورقات written by علامة عبد الملك ابن عبد الله الجويني رحمه الله تعالى. We're not going to go into the biography of the author because we've previously explained this book. But inshallah تعالى, we will بإذن الله الكريم start the book straight away بإذن الله الكريم.
نعم. In the name of Allah, the most merciful, the bestower of mercy. And the author begins. These pages comprise knowledge of aspects of the principles of Islamic law, Usul al-Fiqh. It consists of two distinct parts. The root, al-Asl, is that on which something else is built. The branch, al-Far, is that which is built on something else. Islamic law, Fiqh, is the knowledge of the divinely legislated rulings, al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, that are arrived at by independent reasoning, al-ijtihad.
هذه ورقات تشتمل على معرفة فصول من أصول الفقه، وذلك لفظ مؤلف من جزئين مفردين، أحدهما أصول والآخر الفقه، فالأصل ما يبنى عليه غيره، والفرع ما يبنى على غيره، والفقه معرفة الأحكام الشرعية التي طريقها الاجتهاد.
The author رحمه الله الإمام الجويني رحمه الله, this book of us that we have كتاب الورقات, which deals in one of the sciences of the Sharia. A science without it, a person will not be able to understand the textual evidence, the Kitab and the Sunnah correctly. لذلك, as we previously talked, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said that the dalil and the evidence is Nas musaddaq and bahth muhaqqaq. Nas musaddaq and bahth muhaqqaq. That when a person wants to speak about a matter, they have to have authenticity in that which they are transmitting. That's the first. Second, that is required from that individual is that they accurately deduct correct ruling out of the textual evidence. And the one that deals with the latter of the two is usul al-fiqh, which is correct deduction, coming to a correct result and a correct conclusion is through the science usul al-fiqh. And as we study it more, we will inshallah ta'ala understand it more. The author, in some of the publications of his book, he actually starts with the basmala and the hamdala. And if you have some of the copies of the book, you'll see that the author starts by saying bismillahi ar-rahman ar-rahim, and then he does alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu ala sayyidina muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa ba'du. And others, they don't have that. They don't have the hamdala and the basmala. But this book has nusakh khatiyah kathira. This book has so many different manuscripts. So there's not one copy that can be said that is correct over the other. So if you want, you can start with the basmala and the hamdala. And if you want, you can leave it as you wish. So the author then says, فَهَذِهِ waraqat. These are waraqat. Waraqat is jam'u mu'annath as-salim. It's a plural feminine. It's a plural feminine. Min jumu'u al-qillah. It's taken from jumu'u al-qillah. According to Sibawayhi, it's taken from what? Jumu'u al-qillah. Jumu'u al-qillah is that which is not less than 3 and not more than 10. So it's between 3 to 10. Ma kana madluluhu 'adadan muhaddada la yaqillu 'an 3 ولا يزيد عن عشرة. It's between 3 and 10. And there's also jam'u al-kathra, which is basically anything that is from 10 onwards without a final limit, without any limit after 10. So that's what al-waraqat means. And the reason why he chose, to say and call his book waraqat is because لِقَصْدِ التَّسْهِيلِ عَلَى الْمُبْتَدِي. Pages. Waraqat means pages. So he's saying to you that this book is only pages. To make it easy for the beginner, لِيَنْشَطَ عَلَى قِرَاءَتِهَا وَالْإِلْمَامِ بِمَا فِيهَا. So he can have enthusiasm and he can desire to want to know more because the book is not something big. And based on that, we'll also try to make it a very simple explanation and not to indulge too much into it. So the sharah becomes simple. So it's befitting for what the book is, because the book itself is small. And it's not fair that we explain it in too much details. Then the author says, فَهَذِي وَرَقَاتِ تَشْتَمِلُ عَلَى مَعْرِفَةِ knowing فُصُولٌ مِنْ أُصُولِ الْفِقْهِ. Fusul is a heading that falls under a chapter. وَلِذَلِكَ the scholars, they divide their books in the following. They call it a kitab, which is a book. And then in the kitab falls abwab, bab. So it's a kitab, which is a book. And then underneath the kitab, the book, falls bab. And bab is a chapter. And underneath the bab falls fasl. And the plural for fasl, which is jam'u at-taksir, is fusul. Fusul. Fusul means what? It means subheadings. If that's the correct wording to be used. Min usulul fiqhi. So he's saying to you, this is not going to be a book, and it is also not going to be a bab, but it's going to be something fusul, subheadings, taken from usul al-fiqh. Then the author says, وَهُوَ مُؤَلَّفٌ مِّن جُزْئَيْنِ مُفْرَدَيْنِ. Here there's a point that we have to understand. I don't want to, because he said فُصُول مِّن أُصُولِ الْفِقْهِ. I don't want to explain what it means, أُصُولُ الْفِقْهِ, because we're going to come to it right now. So he says, وَهُوَ مُؤَلَّفٌ. مُؤَلَّفٌ means what? It consists of. مِّن جُزْئَيْنِ, two parts, مُفْرَدَيْنِ, that are singular. The word مُفْرَد, as we know, it can be the opposite of جَمَع. And it can also sometimes be the opposite of what? Jumla, sentence. Sah? Jumla. Ama tarkib. Here is the mufrad, which is the opposite of what? Murakkab. And not the mufrad, which is the opposite of a jama'. So when he says, wa huwa mu'allafun, it consists of min juz'aini, two parts, which are mufradaini. He means that are not sentences. So usul by itself, and al-fiqh by itself. ولذلك the poet, he said, وَالْمُفْرَدُ الْمُضَافُ إِنْ تَرَكَّبَ مَعْ غَيْرِهِ حَتَّى أَتَمَ لَقَبَ فَحَدُّهُ يَكُونُ بِالْإِفْرَادِ لِكُلِّ وَاحِدٍ لَدَى النُّقَادِ ثُمَّ يُعَادُ ثَانِيًا مُرَكَّبَ إِذْ لَقَبَ لَدَيْهِمُ تَرَكَّبَ. If the word is murakkab, it consists of two words, such as what we have here right now. We have usul and then we have fiqh. They are two words. So the way to define it is in two ways. First way to define it is تعريف كل مفرد على حدة. We define each one singularly. So we define usul, what it means. And then we define what al-fiqh means. That's the first way of defining it. And then what we do is we go back to both of them together. Usul and fiqh together. تعريف ذلك التركيب بعد سيرورته لقبا لجملة من مسائل العلم. And then we go back again and we define usul and fiqh together. So the first way we define it is تعريف كل مفردة, defining each of the two independently. So we define what usul means, and then we define what al-fiqh means, and then what do? we go back to it again, and then we define it, both of them together. Usul al-fiqh, what does it mean? Why is it? Because it has become a field that is studied. Because usul al-fiqh together now, these two separate independent words have now become together, and it has become a particular science. It has turned into a particular science. So that's why we have to define it like that. We have to define it like that. And that's why the author, rahimahullah, he says, أَحَدُهُمَا, the first of the two, is أَحَدُهُمَا. The first one is الْأُصُولُ. الْأُصُولُ. أُصُول is جَمْعُ التَّكْسِيرُ. It's a broken plural. أُصُول. It's a broken plural. Because the plurals are how many types? Three types. جَمْعُ مُذَكَّرِ السَّالِمِ, جَمْعُ مُؤَنَّثِ السَّالِمِ, and جَمْعُ التَّكْسِيرُ. This is a broken plural. And the singular for it is what? أَصْل. أَصْل. And the asl is of two types. The word asl is of two types. There's an asl which is ma'nawi, and there's an asl which is hissi. Asl which is ma'nawi is, are you with me? Which is ma'nawi is that the asl that's not tangible. It's not empirical. It's the asl which is your iman. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء. This أصل here is what? It is not something tangible. Are you with me? The second one is أصل which is tangible, and that is أصل الجدار, the foundation of the building. It's tangible. If you go down to it, you can touch it. It's at the bottom. The foundation of a building. The foundation of a building. So the word asal, are you with me, is, it comes in those two types. What does it linguistically mean, the word asal? The word asal linguistically means, asal linguistically means what? It linguistically means, as Al-Imam Al-Juwayni mentions, ma yanbani alayhi ghayruh. Asal means what? It is something that things are built upon. Things are built on it. It's the foundation, and things are built on it. That is what's meant by it, lughatan. Lughatan, that is what it's, that's what's meant by al-aslu. Istilahan, technically, what does asl mean? What does asl technically mean? The reason why we can't technically define what asl means straight away is because we have to understand within the sharia, technically, the word asl comes in more than one usage. So each one has to be understood in order to define it correctly. So you can't technically define it in one definition, because it's used فَيُطْلَقُ عَلَى مَعَانٍ. Many meanings are used. The first one is, الدليل. The asl sometimes is meant by الدليل, evidence. كَقَوْلِنَا, like when we say أصل وجوب الصوم. The asal that the fasting is obligatory is قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Here what do we mean? أي دليله. Here we mean, when we say أصل وجوب الصوم, the asal that the fasting is obligatory, the asal that the fasting is obligatory here means the dalil, that the fasting is obligatory. That's the first usage. The second usage is al-qa'idatul mustamirra. Al-qa'ida al-mustamirra, the continuous principle. So the second usage of the word asal is al-qa'idatul mustamirra, the continuous principle. For example, we will say ibahatul maytati lil muttari ala khilaf al-asli. The permissibility of the dead for the one in need, it's opposite to the asal. What do we mean it's the opposite to the asal here? We mean it's the opposite to the qa'idatul mustamirra, the continuous principle, which was that eating the dead is haram. It now goes against that principle. The third usage is al-maqisu alayhi. The third one is al-maqisu alayhi. It means the thing that the analogy is taken from. The third usage is the thing that the analogy is taken from. when the scholars, inshallah ta'ala, which we're going to be seeing it in Bab al-Qiyas, in the chapter of analogy, the chapter of analogy, when we speak about analogy, we're going to take the analogy has four pillars. The first one is al-aslu, the second one is al-far'u, the third one is al-hukmu, and the last one, which is what? Al-illah. Al-illah. So asl means what? Asl is what? Al-maqisu alayh, the one that the analogy is being taken from. The one that the analogy is being taken from. Sahih? That's the usage of the word asl. Now that we've understood what asl means, lughatan wa istilaha, the author then goes on to wal far'u ma yubna ala ghayrihi. Wal far'u, the far'a is. Now the question scholars asked one another is, why did the author actually bring the definition of al far'u here? But we understand why he brought an asl and why he's defining asl, because he's defining it from what angle? He's defining it because ta'rifu, the definition from the angle of kullu mufradin ala hida. He's defining each one independently. So we understood why he's defining asl, lughatan wa istilaha. But why has he now then gone into al-fara? Why is he bringing fara into the picture? We're not talking about al-fara. The scholars, they say two reasons. The first reason they said is because it's istidrad. He went off topic. And he's trying to teach you the opposite of al-asl. Since you've now learned what al-asl means, he's trying to tell you that the opposite of an asl is what? Al-fara. Fara is the opposite of what? Asl. That's the usage of, that's the reason why he had brought it here, Imam Al-Juwayni rahimahullah. The second reason that the scholars mentioned is because you have to study some furu' fiqhiyya in order to be able to understand usul al-fiqh. If you don't study furu', which is fiqh, usul al-fiqh is ijmaliyya. If you don't study tafsiliyya, which is furu', some fiqhiyyat, if you don't have some fiqh in place, it's not easy for you to study usul al-fiqh. It's not easy for you to study usul al-fiqh. You have to have some fiqh with you in order to understand it. Okay? Here the other issue that the author is critiqued for here right now is, and we're going to see it, is when he had defined usul, what did he define it as? Did he define it lughatan or istilaha? The question here we have to analyze. These are i'tiradat that are put against the book. I'tiradat are oppositions, questions that have been put against Al-Allamah Al-Juwayni rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. What is it, brothers? He defined asl ta'arif lughawiyya. He linguistically defined it. But then let's look at when he defines fiqh. He says, وَالْفِقْهُ مَعْرِفَةُ الْأَحْكَامِ الشَّرْعِيَّةِ الَّتِي طَرِيقُهَا الْإِجْتِهَادِ. Now that he's defining al-fiqh, is he defining it lughatan or is he defining it istilaha? He's defining al-fiqh istilaha. So he is not going according to one. He's not going according to one qanun. He's not following qanun wahid muttarid. He's not following one manner. Because usul and fiqh are what we're working on here right now. We're trying to define it independently, each one, right? So if you've defined usul lughatan, then define fiqh lughatan. Or if you're going to define usul technically, istilaha, then define fiqh istilaha then. Because then you're going according to a qa'idah, and you're going according to what? Qanun wahid muttalid. سَالِمٌ مِنَ الْإِعْلَالِ وَالْإِخْلَالِ. The reason why we will defend the author here right now, even though he's done that, is because he here right now is not following, the author here, is not following a particular principle like that. Because that which I'm mentioning here is a qadiyya, which is تَدْقِيق and تَحْقِيق. It's looking into the issue a bit too much. And Abu Mu'ali al-Juwayni rahimahullah is not doing that. This book is for a beginner. So he's doing what he's doing is مُرَاعَاتِ الْمُصَنِّفِ حَالَ الْمُتَلَقِّينَ. He's only observing those who are going to read his book. They're beginners and he's looking at them as beginners. So he's not doing تَدْقِيق and تَحْقِيق like that. But if anybody wants to hold him account for something and wants to correct him, they have the rights to do that in his other book, Al-Burhan fi Usul al-Fiqh, which he has. And that book of his is a book he authored on a higher level and a higher caliber. He's authored that book to observe at-tatqiq wa at-tahqiq. And any qadaya, any positions which he holds, Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni rahimahullah, he holds in this book, and then we find an opposite of opposite opinion of his in his kitab Al-Burhan fi Usul al-Fiqh. We find another opinion of his in his kitab Al-Burhan fi Usul al-Fiqh. We can't say that there is an iddirab, that there's a contradiction. Inna ra'yahu, his opinion is iddaraba fi al-kitabaini. Within the two books, he's contradicted himself. The answer is no, because the placing of both books are different. One book, he placed it for a particular audience, and the other one, he has placed it for another purpose. So this book, he might have written it in a way and has gone against it in his other kitab, Al-Burhan, fi Usul al-Fiqh. So this kitab is not a kitab which is muharrar for this particular field. Muharrar meaning that he's following at-tadqiq wa-tahqiq. He's trying to follow details and he's trying to observe the way he defines things. Because that's not what he's trying to do here. Are you with me, brothers? Also, when the author rahimahullah came to the issue of al-fiqh and the definition of al-fiqh, he did another point, which is he defined al-fiqh technically. He defined fiqh technically. And we already mentioned that i'tirab. That's number one, which he didn't do for usul. But we said we don't have to hold him account for that. The second thing that he has done here right now is that when he defined it, what is the word that he used? He said, ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyya. He said what? He said, ma'rifa. It is to know. And if we say ma'rifa is, the author has now defined the word connecting the knowledge to the person who's coming with al-fiqh. And that's an incorrect definition. If you're defining something, you don't define the thing based on the person's perception and the person's understanding, because that differs. The word ma'rifa means to perceive and to understand. And to define something based on a characteristics, al-qa'imatun bil-muta'allimi, the one who is learning something in him, that's incorrect. وَإِنَّمَا تُعَرَّفُ بِاعْتِبَارِ كَوْنِهَا قَوَاعِدٍ. But what he should have defined it is as though it's principles. He should have defined it as something that is a principle. For example, now, if we were to define مصطلح الحديث, we will say قواعد is principles. يعرف بها حال الراوي والمروي من القبول والرد. We'll say it is principles. When the person that can know through the principles, are you with me? حال الراوي, the situation of the narrator, والمرويو, and the one who's been narrated from, whether they are accepted or they're rejected. But you don't say معرفة القواعد التي يعرف بها حال الراوي والمرويو من القبول والرد. Why? Because معرفة is a وصف للمتلقي. The reason is because معرفة, knowing, is a matter that stands inside the one who's taking this information. And a science should not be defined on the people who are taking it. Are you with me, brothers? But rather, when it's being defined, it should be defined kawniha, it being qawa'id, principles. The science should be defined it being principles, and not looking at the people who are coming with the science, or the person who's trying to understand the science. Also, the other thing that the author rahimahullah says is الأحكام الشرعية. First of all, what does معرفة mean? معرفة, it encompasses two things. It encompasses اليقين and الشك. And we're going to come to that soon, inshallah ta'ala, what it means. It encompasses two things. When we say معرفة, it means اليقين, certainty, and it also means ظن. Because fiqh accepts ظن. And what does يقين mean? And what does ظن mean? We'll soon, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be إذن الله soon see it. The Sheikh is going to bring it. Are you with me, brothers? So we've defined what ma'rifa means, right? Then the author says, Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, right? Are you with me, brothers? What does the author say? He says, Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, when he's defining it. Are you with me, brothers? Brothers, say yes or no? Na'am. So the author, rahimahullah, he uses unrestrictedly the word Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya. Okay. The question here is that Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya is not one type. Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, are you with me, brothers? Is not of one type. Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya naw'an is two types. The first one, Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, which are khabariyya, khabariyya. Are you with me, brothers? The Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, which are khabariyya, are what is called aqeedah. They are Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, right? But they are khabari. They are khabari. Khabari being information that's been given to you. The second one is Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, which are talabiyya, talabiyya, request. Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya, which are talabiyya. So the author here, rahimahullah, he unrestrictedly used the word Al-Ahkam al-Shar'iyya. Good. Now that we've understood that, the author went on to saying, after he had defined what al-fiqh means, he says, التي طريقها الاجتهاد. So what did he say? معرفة الأحكام الشرعية التي طريقها الاجتهاد. So we learn what معرفة means. We learn الأحكام الشرعية means. And الأحكام الشرعية الطلبية we're going to take soon. Don't worry. That's why I didn't mention it. الأحكام الشرعية الخبرية, you know what it means. It means عقيدة. مسائل which are pertaining to عقيدة. الأحكام الشرعية الطلبية is what? الأحكام الشرعية الطلبية is what? What we're going to be taking later. الأحكام الشرعية التكليفية الوضط. And then the second one is going to be الأحكام الشرعية الوضعية. We're going to be taking that soon بإذن الله الكريم. But the author here says something, which is التي طريقها الاجتهاد. So that knowing the أحكام الشرعية الطلبية, the path for it is what? The path for it is what? Al-Ijtihad. Al-what? Al-Ijtihad. Now this is the mafraq al-turuq. This is the path where the usuliyin and the fuqaha differ on. Are you with me, brothers? This is the path where the fuqaha and the usuliyin, they differ upon. The usuliyin, based on their definition, التي طريقها الاجتهاد, is not in the picture. They just they take it as what? It is معرفة الأحكام الشرعية الطلبية. بس التي طريقها الاجتهاد, this is specific for the أصوليين. What does it mean? With an example, it becomes clear. For example, the statement that says القول بأن الوتر نافلة, that the witr is what? Is a نافلة, is a voluntary prayer. The witr is a what? A voluntary prayer. This is a mas'ala ijtihadiyya. Is it not mas'ala ijtihadiyya? It's a mas'ala ijtihadiyya. So based on the definition that Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni gave here, does it fall under fiqh here? Does witr's being nafila, does it fall under the definition of fiqh? It is ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyya alati tariquha al-ijtihad. Na'am, it's ijtihad. The zakat is wajib. Sah? Zakat is what? Is wajib fil amwal, right? Does it fall under fiqh? Is a mas'ala ijtihadiyya? No, it's not a mas'ala ijtihadiyya. Everyone knows that. It's not a mas'ala that's based on any ijtihad from anybody. Bunya al-Islam ala khamsin, shahadatu an la ilaha illallah, wa anna muhammadan rasulullah, wa iqamu as-salah, wa ita'u az-zakat, wa sawmu ramadan, wa ita'u az-zakat. It's not ijtihad. It's not what? It's not based on ijtihad. So this is al-hadd al-fasil, according to fiqh, what it means to the fuqaha, and that which it means to the usuriyin. Usuriyin are the ones who consider it. Fiqh is masail al-ijtihadiyya. As for the fuqaha, فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْمَدُونَ إِلَى ذَلِكَ. Fuqaha don't see it like that. They see it to be more generic and more general. Na'am.